welcome New Zealand into a World Cup semi-final. Keeper Annalite scores with a feat, a sweet defeat of Japan, while Chelsea are a sorry mess against a super slick Spurs. Lining up for TVNZ Football Club today is Victor Valdez-Water, Simon Plum and Jack Mabea. The Young Football Ferns, how big of a result is this, getting into a semi-final?
Yeah, huge. I mean, obviously the furthest any New Zealand team has ever gone in a FIFA tournament. Great for the girls and great for Kiwi football as well. I think everyone's been loving it. Perhaps not got the kind of coverage that it's deserved, maybe.
They did it the hard way, didn't they?
Yeah, I mean, when your goalkeeper's stepping up to take the deciding penalty, I mean, that's
edge
of your seat sort of stuff, isn't it? Your nails have been bitten off by that stage. But they showed great courage, didn't they, to come through that and get the result. And, Japan are a very fancy team in this tournament. And to claim a big scalp like that is a huge achievement for them and just shows the kind of spirit, I suppose, that's in that team at the moment. They must be over the moon.
It was quite fitting that Annalite actually scored the winning penalty because she's been in such good form this tournament. She's played three times for the senior team and she's really shown her talent this tournament.
She had a fantastic game. I think there's just a few minutes before they went to penalty, she made an outstanding save from this huge shot from just outside the area, or just inside. And I thought, wow, she's looking good, confident. And then, you know, she made one. I think she saved one in the penalty shootout and then the others were misses. And then to have the audacity and the confidence to step up with the deciding kick and put it in the bottom corner, I applaud that confidence and some good signs for the Football Ferns going into the future.
Yeah. She's made some good saves throughout the tournament. She had a couple of really good saves against Ghana. And New Zealand keepers tend to flourish at World Cups because generally they're under the pump.
Yeah, perfect environment for an underdog to thrive, isn't it? The penalty shootout. You get amongst it. But you can't really fail, really, as a goalkeeper in a shootout unless you step up and take a penalty. Mm. And that is just, I mean, it's Roy the Rover stuff, really. Good honour.
I always think it's hard to stand out as a goalkeeper as well because, like, your mistakes, obviously, are very obvious. But to actually stand out and be applauded for your actual goalkeeping abilities is actually quite difficult
it
sometimes.
Is, yeah.
And the other thing with goalkeepers is you have to be sort of slightly mad, don't you? You have to have a bit you know, creative genius. Think you've got to be really outside of the box, purple spot type individual, don't you?
What are you saying about this young lady?
I think she is fantastic and she needs to be applauded. I love that bold flair that she put on and, you know, I just can't applaud it enough.
Yeah.
Also pretty impressive from that team was their goal in normal time, a bit of set-piece brilliance. Dubbed the Heidi, apparently.
Yeah, apparently this is a bit of a hangover from the Andreas Haraf regime. Yeah, maybe the only good thing to come out of his tenure. But, yeah, it was a pretty slick set-piece move. Maybe the men's team could learn a thing or two from that. Yeah.
It was well worked. A couple of dummies in there and the far post run from Amelia Abbott coming back from the far post and obviously having a great strike.
Yeah, they'd have had the defenders tied up in knots around there. I mean, the thing with set-piece moves, though, I always think, is that if they don't come off, they look terrible, right? So you've actually got to have a lot of courage to actually try and pull it off and execute it as well, because under pressure in the game environment, sometimes, those little nerves can get to you and you can make a little mistake. So it's great to see one and it's actually pulled off to perfection like that.
People scoff at set pieces, though. They say, oh, you only scored from a set piece. But I sort of like the fact that you score from set pieces. They're supposed to be scoring opportunities and it's actually nice to see them executed well, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that plays to New Zealand's strength. You know, if you look at the New Zealand players compared to the Japanese players, we're a lot bigger, a lot more physical. So I think balls into the box, things like that Heidi manoeuvre are going to play to our advantages, and we've got to do that, you know.
Yeah.
Does it sit well with your Spanish side, though, Victor? You like them to pass into the back.
Look, I thought there was enough flair in there for it to it was very well executed, and props to the coach Leon Burney for, you know, having the confidence to bring that into the team and even though it's Haraf's move, but, you know, to practice that and to, you know, give them the confidence to say, look, try that out.
She needed to strike it with the outside of the boot, I presume.
Absolutely.
Yeah, the full mark.
Piece the resistance. Yeah. But anyway, look, great goal.
Well, set pieces are, a great opportunity to score, aren't they? Because, I mean, you have the advantage. You've got the ball. You've got the opportunity. So why not use it to maximise
And look at England at the World Cup.
Yeah, Harry
Kane.
Yeah.
So far. So,
absolutely.
You know, they lacked some, tactical, playmaker style, but
it's hard to actually get a set-piece move off a penalty, but I do remember Arsenal trying it once.
Robert Pires, Thierry Henry.
And it went disastrously wrong. It was very funny. Seek it out if...
the penalty?
Yeah.
Yeah, but then Messi did it with Suarez in La Liga a few years ago.
Oh, here we go. It was a way to bring it back to Messi.
Beautiful. Yeah.
Also going quite well for New Zealand are the Football Ferns. Mm. They've got a semi-final this evening at 5 p.m. against New Caledonia. Mm-hmm. That should be pretty easy pickings again through the final.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's probably fair for us on a couch to say that they should cruise through that. I'm sure the players wouldn't. But, yeah, I mean, you can't really see it going wrong for them, barring some kind of catastrophic refereeing decision. Which...
Or a terrible pitch. Some of them have been absolute shockers. Mm. But in saying all that, I think if my calculations are correct... Here we go, because I'm not great with maths, but the Football Ferns have scored 27 goals so far in this tournament.
Yeah, yeah. It's kind of ridiculous, isn't it?
It's a bit silly.
Okay, yeah. Another chance for people to get on the goal-scoring charts this evening then. They should get through to the final, and then it's hopefully into the Olympics and World Cup as well. So it's looking pretty rosy for New Zealand football at this stage of both tournaments there. We're going to have a wee break now. Coming up after this, we're going to get stuck into some Premier League action where a swashbuckling Spurs totally dismantled Chelsea. How about those Spurs, eh? Pretty good. 3-1 against Chelsea. It was the performance I've been waiting for because they've sort of got results without really hitting top gear. Victor, your prediction obviously didn't come to fruition.
You were very chuffed. You were messaging all of us throughout that game, rubbing it in our faces.
But it was.
I think it was exactly the opposite of what a lot of us expected. I thought, you know, after the international break, Tottenham don't have a big squad. They'll be tired. But it was Chelsea that looked tired. It was Chelsea that just, they weren't in the game. No. And David Luiz, jeepers. Chelsea need to do something about that defence.
I thought it was a case of, that's the best Tottenham have been all season and probably the worst Chelsea have been all season. But to look at Tottenham first, I think that might be the first time that Son and the big four have all actually played together.
Yeah,
and they look a different side. They were, like you say, they just dismantled Chelsea. And I think a lot of it was taking Jorginho out of the play, and they didn't have an answer for it. They had nothing.
Yeah, it was a tactical, masterclass, if you like. But in a way, I mean, it seems so obvious, doesn't it? Just to sort of stifle Jorginho, stop the supply from the defence to the attack. It seems like a big vulnerability for them.
Mm. Well, has it been a good idea to take Kante out of that defensive midfield position?
He could have done a job for him, couldn't he?
It's crazy. Yeah. You've got one of the world's best defensive midfielders playing him out of position. Why would you do that?
On the other hand, was it just a bad day at the office for Chelsea? Tottenham looked really good with that front four. Mm. And you've sort of got a similar situation to Liverpool and City, where you've got a focal point and just havoc being created all around it. Having Kane there with Son, Ali, Eriksen... Mm. The fluidity of having those guys up front just takes it to another level, doesn't it?
It does, really. I don't know if they're in the same bracket as Liverpool yet, but I think they're definitely knocking on. They've got that third position pretty... They're in a good state to tackle Chelsea for that, as we saw. But I think that top four is now very much a split of the top two than the bottom two in it. But good on Tottenham. If they can make a fist for it, it's only good for the title race.
Someone we talked about last week, Claudio Ranieri, first game with Fulham against Southampton, 3-2, and Mitrovic banging a couple in as well. They look good.
Yeah, he's sort of got the confidence back in the team. Mitrovic, I don't think, had scored in 5 match days or something like that. 2 goals, 2, you know, predator-like goals in the box. He's, you know, it looks like he's got a nose for the goal back on.
It was a nice game for Fulham to have first up for Ranieri, wasn't it?
Yeah, and apparently he's been trying to organise them a lot more defensively.
Yeah.
They were speaking to some of the players, and they said the other guy, referring to their previous manager, didn't do any real defensive work with them. Didn't get them like organised like that. And you could have seen that, you know, in the previous games this season. But Ranieri's come in and he's said, right, first things first, let's get this defence sorted out. Didn't quite work out, I suppose, on the weekend. But you know, work in progress, I suppose.
No clean sheet, no McDonald's for them.
Yeah, exactly.
Arsenal won 2-1 against Bournemouth, who've been high flying under Eddie Howe, but a contender for one of the most explosive own goals this season, certainly.
You just sort of look at it and go, I can see what he was trying to do, but he really did not execute it well. He did not cover himself in glory. I thought Bournemouth went into that game with possibly the wrong game plan. And I think Arsenal sort of just got their momentum going in that game, and they were just too strong in the end.
Yeah, a lot of talk about Ozil being on the bench there as well, wasn't there?
His
future at the club. I mean, he's their easily the highest paid player at the moment, I think, and one of their record signings, and he doesn't even get a sniff at the first team at the moment.
Well, we talked about him a couple of months putting on a really sublime performance against Leicester, and then Emery comes out and says he's not basically tough enough for this game. This game is too hard for him. Mm. It's a bit strange, isn't it?
So I wonder if he's picking his games a little bit carefully, you know, if it's more of a sort of a technical kind of tactical match than perhaps Oates will get to.
There have been rumblings that he doesn't quite get along very well with Emery. And I'm just going back to his time in Spain. There were a lot of accusations that he wasn't a player that could play 90 minutes. He would get gassed out. He didn't have very good stamina. And so I just wonder if that is still a lingering problem for Ozil. I mean, he's a fantastic player, class act, but...
Mm-hmm. It seems really inconsistent, though, because he was amazing a couple of months ago against Leicester and put in 90 minutes and was spellbinding. He was amazing.
It just feels like that is the essence of Mesut Ozil. Like, there is just no rhyme or reason to that guy. He's either amazing or he's just not on the pitch. Yeah. I think, but to go back to Arsenal, I think that kind of grinding a result out, they wouldn't have done that against Bournemouth not too long ago. I think they've definitely turned the corner a bit. I think the manager should take a lot of credit for that.
I wonder if fans as well like the fact that Emery dropped Ozil as well, or actually kept him out and said, right, I'm putting in my own team, you guys go and get a result instead.
Yeah, Arsenal Fan TV firing up and making the managerial decisions from the sidelines.
To be fair, it hasn't gone amiss. 17 games unbeaten in all competitions now for Arsenal. You know, they're on their way up.
They are, yeah.
This North London derby is going to be very tasty.
Yeah, massive weekend. Right.
Yeah, well, I'll say North London derby against Tottenham is slightly different to playing against Carabag in the Europa League. But anyways, City 4-0 against West Ham, totally imperious again, and Liverpool 3-0 against Watford. Raheem Sterling is taking his game to another level again.
Well, he's in my fantasy team now.
You're a week too late by the looks of it.
I've taken a points cut. He's in. I mean, he's just every game day he's doing something.
Yeah, he seems to be improving, doesn't he, all the time as well, which is really good. And that must be partly down to Pep, you'd imagine, on the training ground and utilising his pace and his skills as well. Because finishing was always a big problem for him, wasn't it?
Yeah,
he was
frustrating.
Very wayward with his shots, but it seems like he's kind of getting on top of
it. Funny you
now.
Say that, because he gets a lot of stick for his finishing, but yet I think in the past few seasons he's scored more goals than Eden Hazard,
what's his shot conversion rate like?
Yeah, but he gets the goals in those positions, though, doesn't he? You always find Raheem Sterling popping up in the right places in the six-yard box.
That's right, You've got to be in it to win it. And if you look at his movement, the goal that he scored, he wouldn't have done that. He wouldn't have taken the chance to run at the far post previously. But I think Pep's had a massive effect on him. Yeah, his shooting's a little bit wayward at times, like you say, but as an England fan, he's infuriating to watch at times. But he gets himself nine times out of ten to create the chance, and you've got to be there.
But with City, you're going to get a lot of chances, aren't you?
That's true.
If he was playing in a team which didn't create as many chances...
Sour grapes, Beasy, because he left Liverpool.
He played well for Liverpool.
But he's certainly matured under Pep. I think Pep's given him an extra dimension to his game, and I think for England fans, he's a very exciting prospect.
Yeah.
Salah looks like he's back in the groove of things, is he?
Yeah, he seems to be much happier, playing with a smile on his face again. The strapping's come off his shoulder. He's even having sly digs at Ramos, it appears.
Do we think that?
Love it. Love it.
After the goal. Well, he's not confirmed or denied it.
Enlighten us, what happened there?
Well, Ramos has got this goal celebration. It's sort of like crossed hands
kind
of thing.
Like that.
And so after Salah had scored his goal, he made that gesture. And this was coming the day after Ramos had been in trouble for not declaring an anti-inflammatory, I think, that he'd been busted for.
Well, he is always inflaming this situation. Yeah. I'd quite like to see this little duel between them carry on. Can we expect more fireworks?
It seems to be all the Liverpool players are having a bit of a dig at Ramos lately, so there's certainly no love lost there after that Champions League final. Yeah.
And I think Liverpool's season looks like it's going to be much better than Madrid's.
Yeah.
They had sixth at the moment in La Liga and not looking great.
Mm. I would like to see them maybe exact some sweet revenge on them in the Champions
League. Wouldn't we all, mate?
Just a quick preview ahead of two big derbies next week. Liverpool playing Everton.
Mm.
That should be fairly straightforward, shouldn't it?
Never know, do you? With derby day. Liverpool would be the favourites going into it.
Mm.
But
of course you'd say that.
Yeah, but Liverpool have got a big game against Paris coming up this week
as
well.
That's tasty. That's it really
nice. Neymar and Mbappe both fit for that game.
Yeah, so that's one that they probably need to win, really, to kind of guarantee progress the knockout stages. So there's a few question marks over what sort of team Klopp might pick for the derby, whether he'll rest some of his better players after two hard games in the previous week. So that'll be interesting. But the Liverpool derby is always sort of a blood and thunder sort of thing.
It is,
and, guaranteed to finish 0-0, basically.
Tottenham have got Inter, and then they have to play Europa's League's finest, Arsenal. How do we see that one playing out?
I think Tottenham are going to have too much, but I think in the second game, Arsenal could have a chance there. Tottenham, their squad is, their depth is the issue we've spoken about before. I think Arsenal might just have a bit of a window in there in a derby game.
I think if they hadn't beaten Chelsea so convincingly, I would have been maybe a little bit more concerned. I'll take a draw away at the Emirates, but Arsenal would have a little bit of confidence going into this, thinking they can get a result on the back of this good run.
Sure, I mean, both teams are on the up, but again, I'm a bit like you. I think it's going to be a draw. I think maybe a high-scoring draw, but yeah, I can't see anyone winning that game.
OK, sitting on the fence, everybody, this morning.
The one.
Fantastic. OK, that is us for this week. Best of luck to the young football ferns on Thursday morning from all of us at TVNZ. Remember, we're on the One News website, YouTube and Facebook pages. You can find the podcast on iTunes and SoundCloud under TVNZ Football Club. We'll see you next week.